I'm Robert Pinsky, and it is always my pleasure to say a little bit about the nature of this Robert Lowell Memorial Lecture Series in the spirit of Room 222. Room 222 at 236 Bay State Road is where Leslie Epstein and Hod Gin and Dan Chazen and Henri Cole and I still teach the creative writing seminars at BU. And it is in that room that Robert Lowell taught a seminar in which the students included Sylvia Plath, Anne Sexton, and George Starbuck. And when Nancy Livingston and Fred Levin for the Shenson Foundation decided to endow a series here, we talked about that room. And we decided that one of the interesting things about the spirit of that room is that the point is not that Robert Lowell was the professor and Plath, Sexton, and Starbuck were the students. They were artists. They were poets together. And we decided we would have a reading series in which someone closer to the beginning in the art introduced a distinguished visitor and gave a very brief reading to introduce the visitor. And it is the spirit of art cooperating as a happy, honored guest in the context of scholarship and academic study. So to say in the spirit of Room 222 is to express a kind of happy and included but distinct element of art in the element of ordinary pedagogy. And it happens to be particularly appropriate, partly by accident, to have Becca Stout introducing Paul Muldoon. Paul Muldoon is musical and a musician, and it is characteristic of Becca Stout as a person and as a poet that she is, I'll go back to the word artist. Becca is an accomplished and talented musician, and she is an accomplished and talented visual artist as well. I'll say a few more words introducing Becca. She'll then give a very brief poetry reading and introduce Paul. And after that, we'll have a reception out there. Grateful to our hosts at Mugar that are going to let us have things to eat and drink out there. And Paul will be happy to sign books. I've said that Becca Stout is an artist in two or three different senses of the word. Her poems strike one perhaps at first with a lot of imagination. Imagination distorting and refracting and surprising in a way that we loosely call surreal. But the fact is, if there's a horse or a lion or a fawn in a poem by Rebecca Stout, it's also perceived with a lot of knowledge and attention to the actual reality of that creature. So that for me, there's a very engaging combination of wild imagination and of fidelity to what used to be called nature or the world. Becca has published here and there. I'm proud and happy to say that she has work included in the Stay Thirsty Media annual volume, Emerging Poets of 2013, here as a poet who has emerged years back here at Boston University, Rebecca Stout.
Thank you so much, Robert. It's goes without saying, it's quite an honor to be here, and I never would have imagined. I think I've been coming to these for 6 years now. 6 years ago, I never would have imagined I'd be up here reading. So it's a real pleasure. So a lot of my poems have come out of conversations with a guitarist that I had the opportunity to study with for many years. Conversations about the imagination, and I found that after I moved away from the States to England for a few years, those conversations continued to resonate with me, and still do to this day. So this is one of those poems that kind of is an extension of one of those conversations. in a manner of speaking. This horse. I've let him out to graze in the diminishing light. He trots ahead, knows where to go. He's leading me to the grass edged with pink, dewstruck, the dark growing up slowly like another edible species. He trusts his lips to part the blades, to find what's delicate. His tongue will do the rest. I've seen him dividing the good bits from the chaff, his tongue dividing and dividing until it seems that he lives on nothing, so much chaff falling from his lips. Not long ago, this horse fit in the palm of my hand. Life was losing him, then finding him again under a teacup or mired in radiator dust. He was always sick until we found this pasture that grows by the acre. This horse grows even faster. Soon we'll have to move again, despite the grass that reaches almost to my chin. His belly sways far above me. I watch the sun set between his hocks as he tears mouthful after mouthful of grass. My horse has outgrown me. I pull out my fiddle to try to tell him so, but it's brittle from all this travel. The bow is stripped and won't sound. Imagine your hand is as big as a house, he calls down to me, and feed me an apple. I realized after trying to write poems for a few years that I'd never actually written a poem, a love poem, for my husband. This was my attempt, but when I showed it to Rosanna Warren, who I was studying with at the time, she said, oh, this is great. This is about love, finding love, but realizing that it's not really enough. Like, okay, so this is for Jeff. And so, at Fox Canyon. Something unhinges from the landscape. A bobcat. Creeping. You remember the face. I remember only the way it moved. All body. The head is missing. Earlier that day, I wrote you a love letter while you slept on the couch in the other room. Sweet and patience. And behind it all moved the world. Unfelt. Unfound. Your mother's prize arrowheads planted on the white windowsill. The room white, my own arrowheads still buried, days spent searching, the white page darkens with it. This is a poem in kind of a different tenor. It's very short. Actually, I have Zui, who organized this whole thing, to thank for it. He gave me a prompt to write a poem in 8 lines. And he gave an example of, we were looking at Vietnamese poetry that uses particular sound, kind of, it's not like rhyme, but it's more that the stress and length of the syllables determines what comes at the end of a line. So that was my challenge. And it ended up being the first poem I was able to write about my mother, who has been suffering from dementia at a very early age. I know some of you have probably been through this experience with someone. It's called Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's. Inside the burnt offering, the charred skull, fur black as a wall, scarred by votive smoke, the dog lives. Her eyes sputter deep within, watchful but not detached. Her body is an accident. Coincidence as loud in her as any empty hallway filled with time's tattoo. Who but the clock to lick these wounds? Synapses slipped the wire cage are now the bright bird in the tree, domestic and doomed. Who to teach the dog to stay? I'm going to read 2 more short poems, both of which came out of my experience as a Robert Pinsky Global Fellow in Greece, where I had an opportunity to travel around Greece for 3 months and read and write. What more could you ask for? So, the pact. Oh, actually, I need to say something else about this one. I know a few of you have already heard this story, but it's important, I've realized, through this story. I was seeing a new therapist, And he'd asked me about my writing, and I'd mentioned that I'd written this new poem that I was interested in. And he said, well, can I see it? And I said, well, okay, I have it here. So I handed it to him, and he read it. Then he looks up, and he had this look on his face. I've never seen anyone give me this look before. And he said, well, I don't really know what to make of this. It's a poem about a prepubescent deer chasing a woman. With sexual intent. And I said, no. So he said, you know, I use the word fawn, F-A-U-N, but he had read it F-A-W-N, so that was the problem. So it's fawn, F-A-U-N. So just so we're clear on that. There are no prepubescent deer in this. Okay. All right. The Pact. Somewhere, some girl is being chased by a greasy fawn. I've seen their tracks in wet pavement, in snow. Listen, you can hear them crashing through the woods, the girl just out of reach, screaming like a jay. In some bar, she leans into his hot breath, opens her dress, and points. This is how to scare me. This, she says, is where it hurts. All right, and the final poem, The Ariadne Institute on Tour. There really is an Ariadne Institute. You can all travel to Crete and learn all about the goddess. I happened to stumble into them when I was on my fellowship and got to experience Knossos through them in a very special way. The Ariadne Institute on Tour. The women rise from their found seats of stumps and boulders in the only shady spot in all of Knossos. They walk single file, spaced several feet apart. They do not speak. They've come to find the goddess. Silence will help them find her faster. Another thing they know, the path that leads to the sacred center is never straight. They appreciate the crooked track they walk, forged by their leader, big as an elk and very blonde. Christ is her surname. The women call her Carol. At the back of the line, one woman wields a parasol. Another holds a box no bigger than her palm. From time to time, she opens the box, peers in, then quickly snaps it shut. What does she have inside that box? The dark-eyed goddess wants to know. She lingers a while and tries to get a decent look inside the box, but fails. The two last women stop to inspect the pithi huddled back in the darkness of a room. Come out, they whisper to the huge vessels skulking in the corner, and don't be shy. The metal placard reads, used to store oil and wine or bury the dead. The smaller pots were used for children. They'd like to look inside, but respect the nylon cord. Admire the knobs and cracks from a distance. Imagine what it would be like to be inside and dead. Inside the box, it's cool, black, and empty. The goddess stands beside them without breathing, craning her neck to see while no one hears her griffin stretch his wings and pop his sinews. Thank you. I meant to thank not only Robert, but Zwi, both of you, for your wisdom and support over the years. It goes to both of you. It's meant a lot. You both changed my life, so thank you. But on to my real job, which I told Robert this morning. You know, having to read poems before one of the poets whom I most admire is kind of nerve-wracking, of course, but having to do an introduction after Robert does an introduction, who always does them so well, is also kind of nerve-wracking, so here I go. It's I'm gonna start with a story. So it's 2006. I've recently moved to Oxford, and I am in Blackwell's bookshop, just to browse, right, just to browse. In the fiction section, my eyes are drawn to the new display featuring one of the most beautiful, irresistible books I have ever seen. Roaming over the entire cover of this book, was the gorgeous group of mares and foals painted by George Stubbs, who some of you may know probably was the greatest horse portraitist of all time. And given my lifelong obsession with horses, this was enough to make me weak-kneed, and I definitely had to grab the book immediately and open it up. And the book was Horse Latitudes by Paul Muldoon. And at that time, I was pretty new to poetry and very new to contemporary poetry. I'd heard his name, but I'd never read a poem. But even so, as I stood there reading the book, I became aware of this hair-raising, tingling shiver passing through me, and this thought that just came to me immediately, which was, this is the work of one of the great virtuosos of our time. And you know, to discover the work of a poet who engaged with such a variety of forms and with so much facility and ambition was thrilling, as were the mercurial rhymes and wild words, which seemed to be plucked from every corner of the language. For instance, let's see, in the examples I just pulled, it's very easy to find. I mean, there's so many great words in all of his books, but in Horse Latitudes, to a penny, right flim flammers, foldy roldy does, did I say that right? Okay. Swallow-tailed swallows, Marcus Aurelius, the boucherie, and a slap on the ass all have their place in this poetry. The concision and whimsy, the seductive understatement, and what I'd call the brave omissions floored me, and all of it was tough as nails, with such intelligence and unsugared empathy that I really appreciated. The challenges presented by the poems, and there were many, were the kind that made me want to continue reading and to continue learning more about how to read poetry and as well as how to write it. So it was an exhilarating and hugely motivating experience to discover your work. Anyway, not to keep you in suspense, I bought the book. And happily, he has published several books since then. The most recent is Word on the Street, published last year, which is actually their poems that double as rock song lyrics, several of which have been recorded by his band, The Wayside Shrines. Yes, a band. He has a band. He writes lyrics for it, and he also plays guitar, if I'm right. He is a professor at Princeton University and the poetry editor for The New Yorker. He's been hailed by the Times Literary Supplement as the most significant English language poet born since the Second World War, and his numerous awards include a Pulitzer Prize for his book Moy Sand and Gravel and a T.S. Eliot Prize for the Annals of Chile. Please join me in welcoming Paul Muldoon.
Thank you very much indeed for that wonderful introduction. And what a delight to be here reading with you and with Robert and everyone else. I'm going to read for 40 minutes or so, if I may, and where to begin? I'll begin with a poem, if I may, by Robert Lowell, whose shade, if indeed it is a shade, his It's a bodied out shade. I'm thinking about that myself, who presides over this meeting. I had the great pleasure of meeting him in 1972 while I was a student at the Queen's University of Belfast. And one of the delights then, of course, was that one could see that this poet, who was world famous, he was at the height of his career at that time, was also just a regular-ish kind of guy. Ish. A guy, mind you, who was very interested, I think perhaps overly interested in poetry, if there is such a thing, but still a regular guy. Memories of West Street and Lipka. Only teaching on Tuesdays, bookworming in pajamas, fresh from the washer each morning. I hog a whole house on Boston's hardly passionate Marlborough Street, where even the man scavenging filth in the back alley trash cans has two children, a beach wagon, a helpmate, and is a young Republican. I have a 9-month daughter, young enough to be my granddaughter. Like the sun, she rises in her flame flamingo infant's wear. These are the tranquilized 50s, and I am 40. Ought I to regret my seed time? I was a fire-breathing Catholic CO and made my manic statement, telling off the state and president, and then sat waiting sentence in the bullpen beside a Negro boy with curlicues of marijuana in his hair. Given a year, hard line to read that, given a year, it means, of course, that he was given a year in jail. Given a year, I walked on the roof of the West Street jail, a short enclosure like my school soccer court, and saw the Hudson River once a day through sooty clothesline entanglements and bleaching khaki tenements. Strolling, I yammered metaphysics with Abramovitz, a jaundice yellow, it's really tan, and flyweight pacifist, so vegetarian he wore rope shoes and preferred fallen fruit. He tried to convert Beoff and Brown, the Hollywood pimps, to his diet. Hairy, muscular, suburban, wearing chocolate double-breasted suits, they blew their tops and beat 'em black and blue. I was so out of things, I'd never heard of the Jehovah's Witnesses. Are you a CO? I asked a fellow jailbird. No, he answered. I'm a JW. He taught me the hospital tuck and pointed out the T-shirted back of Murder Incorporated's Czar Lepka, there piling towels on a rack, or dawdling off to his little segregated cell full of things forbidden the common man, a portable radio, a dresser, two toy American flags tied together with a ribbon of Easter palm. Flabby, bald, lobotomized, he drifted in a sheepish calm, where no agonizing reappraisal jarred his concentration on the electric chair, hanging like an oasis in his air of lost connections. I'm going to go back and read a couple of poems set in the part of Northern Ireland where I was brought up. This first one I've been thinking about a lot over the last few weeks. It's a poem about the Cuban Missile Crisis, or at least it's set at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And needless to say, as our relations with Russia are a little frayed at the moment, one is reminded of the Chile relations back in that era, when of course it looked very much as if the world was going to be ending fairly promptly with a great bang. And needless to say, as Catholics, in this little Catholic parish, we were encouraged to go to confession in anticipation of shortly meeting our Maker and having our stories straight. So, and our slates clean. Cuba. My eldest sister arrived home that morning in her white muslin evening dress. "Who the hell do you think you are, running out to dances in next to nothing? As though we hadn't enough bother with the world at war, if not at an end. My father was pounding the breakfast table. Those Yankees were touch and go as it was. If you'd heard Patton in Armagh. But this Kennedy's nearly an Irishman, so he's not much better than ourselves. And him with only to say the word. If you've got anything on your mind, maybe you should make your peace with God." I could hear May from beyond the curtain. "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned. I told a lie once. I was disobedient once. And Father, a boy touched me once. Tell me, child, was this touch immodest? Did he touch your breast, for example?" "He brushed against me, Father, very gently." So in this little parish, my mother was the school teacher, or one of the two grade school teachers, which meant, of course, that I went to school more or less regularly. She dragged me out with her. This is a poem about a guy who very rarely showed up at school. If he did, it was an occasion, actually. It was marked. And a poem about his life then and more recently. The first part of his name, can you hear me okay, by the way? Does it sound all right? I feel slightly tethered to this. I may start walking around in a minute. First part of his name was Joseph Mary Plunkett, and which is a great name. It tells you a lot about him. It suggests accurately that since it is echoic of, perfectly echoic, no, it's actually the same name, it's not echoic. It's the same name as one of the poet patriots who took part in the 1916 rising in Dublin and who was shot for his part in it. So with that name actually comes a little thumbnail sketch of his political world picture, I suppose. He's into militant republicanism, and he's not quite a young Republican in the Lowell sense, but sort of going in that direction in some ways. So here we go. Anshaw. When the master was calling the roll at the primary school in College Lands, you were meant to call back Anshaw and raise your hand as your name occurred. Anshaw, meaning here and now, all present and correct, was the first word of Irish I spoke. The last name on the ledger belonged to Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward and was followed, as often as not, by silence, knowing looks, a nod and a wink, the master's droll. And where's our little ward of court? I remember the first time he came back, the master had sent him out along the hedges to weigh up for himself and cut a stick with which he would be beaten. After a while, nothing was spoken. He would arrive, as a matter of course, with an ash plant, a sally rod, or finally the hazel wand he had whittled down to a whip lash. Its twist of red and yellow lacquers, sanded and polished, and altogether so delicately wrought that he had engraved his initials on it. I last met Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward in a pub just over the Irish border. He was living in the open, in a secret camp on the other side of the mountain. He was fighting for Ireland, making things happen. And he told me, Joe Ward, of how he had risen through the ranks to quartermaster, commandant, how every morning at parade his volunteers would call back Anshaw and raise their hands as their names occurred. Now, needless to say, in this part of the world, there was not a great deal happening on the social front. We had to make our own amusement, entertain ourselves, though sometimes we were presented with striking new concepts. I know this is not going to seem out of the ordinary to you in this part of the world, where the concept of the roundabout or rotary is so ingrained in your experience. But you know, there has to be a first time for everything. And in this case, this was the first roundabout in Ireland, which was being built in the vicinity of where we lived. This is a poem which features aspects of that great construction. I mention along the way, the B Specials, who were an auxiliary force of the Royal Ulster Constabulary, the police force, who tended to misbehave, sometimes quite spectacularly, and were shut down, closed down in the early 1970s, around about the time Robert Lowell came to town. I don't think there's a connection between the two. Not certain. The Sash My Father Wore is a song sung by the followers of King William of Orange and Nassau, King Billy, one of our heroes. So the Sightseers. That I'm going to do something else. We'll have one more in this vein, and then we'll do something else, because I think it's time, isn't it? Yeah. The Sightseers. My father and mother, my brother and sister and I, with Uncle Pat, our dour, best-loved uncle, had set out that Sunday afternoon in July in his broken-down Ford, not to visit some graveyard. One died of shingles, one of fever, another's knees turned to jelly. But the brand new roundabout at Ballygolly, the first in Mid-Ulster. Uncle Pat was telling us how the B Specials had stopped him one night somewhere near Ballygolly and smashed his bicycle and made him sing the Sash and curse the Pope of Rome. They held a pistol so hard against his forehead, there was still the mark of an O when he got home. A little song lyric. Sorry, I didn't really get a chance to unpack my bag here, so I'm gradually. So, I'm sure many of you will have been as excited as I was to learn a week or two ago that yet again Fleetwood Mac would be on tour, right? You know, with the entire lineup, insofar as we remember what that might have been. Can you hear me okay? So this is a song which I suppose is inspired. That's a rather
not a grand term for it, inspired partly by a sense of so many of these, what would one say, senior rock acts. Seniors, okay. We're seniors. Seniors, great. It's a wonderful thing to be. These senior rock acts coming back and just, you know, having another lap, as it were. So this is a love song. Some of it's a bit dated, which is almost inevitable. But I'm sure you'll get the general gist, or maybe too much of it. Anyway, let's have a go at this. So it's called Come Back. We were introduced by Bruce at the Stone Pony. All that concentrated juice, standing room only. You were with some suit from EMI or Sony who was so full of toot he called for Moni Moni. You came back to the slum, the squat with Lars and Sammy. Then Lanois' green thumb grew us a golden Grammy. And then our double album hit a double whammy. When it reached number one, we reached for our Swami to make a comeback. A comeback, don't you see? It's time to come back. Come back to me. Then our master's voice told us it was cool to park the Rolls Royce in the swimming pool, while our drugs of choice were run from Istanbul through a girl called Joyce, whose real name was Mule. We loved the paparazzi flash, the paparazzi zoom. When we finished our stash of magic mushrooms, we'd pay in cash for a kilo of Khartoum and come back to trash another hotel room. Making a comeback, comeback, don't you see? It's time to come. When we broke up, we swore we'd never kiss and tell, never speak to each other until hell freezes over, or whatever hell does, when it's co-produced by Eno and Woz. But behind the music and Where Are They Now have pointed the way. They've shown us how to take a leaf from Plant and Page and Fleetwood Mac and set the stage for a comeback. Come back, don't you see? It's time to come back. Come back to me. We'd no sooner said farewell than it was time to reunite. A flame's likelier to swell in a diminished light. For though we're a hard sell, what with the cellulite, we're still clear as a bell. We're still pretty tight. So let's remember the, oops, you see that? Let's remember the fans as we fan the embers and hit the meadowlands this coming September. When we take each other's hands, baby, let's remember we're just another band with only two surviving members. Making a comeback, maybe, from yet another rave. A comeback, maybe, a comeback from the grave.
Thank you. You know, I'll read a poem which, as you know, in the Judeo-Christian tradition, the season of Passover and Easter. I'll read a poem about an animal. One of the first poems I wrote, it's about a little hedgehog that used to come round to our house, come round to the back door in the winter, and we would leave some milk out for it. And we could hear it
drinking the milk from the little tin plate. And of course, we'd open the door. Suddenly, in the hopes of seeing it, and of course, it had always disappeared. So it's a poem having to do with
something that's a little elusive. It refers along the way to a vehicle which back in that era seemed to be one of the coming things. Some of you may remember it. The hovercraft. Do you remember that phenomenon? I know we still have a few of them around, but not as many as I think we thought we'd have by this stage in the game, you know? Because I think we thought, I mean, even we thought, and we didn't have Boston Harbor or anything, even we thought back in Ireland that they'd be all over the place, and we'd maybe driving them ourselves. In any case, so I just, there's an allusion to hovercraft in this poem. Hedgehog. The snail moves like a hovercraft, held up by a rubber cushion of itself, sharing its secret with the hedgehog. The hedgehog shares its secret with no one. We say, hedgehog, come out of yourself and we will love you. We mean no harm. We want only to listen to what you have to say. We want your answers to our questions. The hedgehog gives nothing away, keeping itself to itself. We wonder what a hedgehog has to hide, why it so distrusts. We forget the God under this crown of thorns. We forget that never again will a God trust in the world. So I'll move on to another of my favorite animals, the turkey buzzard. And as you know, the turkey buzzard is an animal which was more or less exclusive to the southeastern states, Florida, down that part of the world, until actually the great, one theory is that after the Ikes, as Lowell calls them, Ikes, great interstate highway system, the turkey buzzard was presented with a wonderful opportunity to kind of extend its range. And that's certainly one theory. People, you know, people know a lot about the turkey buzzard, but there are many aspects of the bird or the animal. You know, we call it an animal. We really don't know too much about. You know, its stomach, for example, is a quite mysterious phenomenon. In any case, I find myself writing a poem about a turkey buzzard or turkey buzzards. And the time I was writing it, it coincided really with the illness of my sister. She suffered from ovarian cancer, as did my mother, and died from it at a young age. So the poem really turns into a kind of elegy about her. It's a little bit heavy in places, but you know, if you can bear that, we'll move on and do something else. It's heavy duty, but you're... It's that time of year. Turkey buzzards. They've been so long above it all. Those two petals, so steeped in style, they seem to stall in the kettle, simmering over the town dump. Or better still, the neon-flashed, X-rated rump of fresh roadkill, courtesy of the interstate that Eisenhower would overtake in the home straight by 1 horsepower. The kettle, which is, by the way, the technical term for a group of buzzards, the kettle where it all boils down to the thick scent of death, a scent of such renown, it's given vent to the idea buzzards can spot a deer carcass a mile away. Smelling the rot as once Marcus Aurelius wrinkled his nose at a gas leak from the great sewer that ran through Rome to the Tiber. Then went searching out through the gloam, one subscriber to the other view, that the rose, full-blown, antique, its no-frills ruff, the 6-foot shrug of its swing wings, the theologians and the thugs, twin triumphings in a buzzard's shaved head and snood, buzz, buzz, buzzy, its logic in all likelihood somewhat fuzzy, would ever come into focus, it ever deign to dispense its hocus-pocus in that same vein as runs along an inner thigh to where, to right, the buzzard vouchsafes not to shy away from shite, its mission not to give a miss to a Betmore, all roly-poly full of piss and vinegar, trying, rather, to get to grips with the grommet of the gut, setting its tin snips to that grommet in the spray-painted hind's hind gut, and making a sweeping, to right, a sweeping cut that's so blasé, it's hard to imagine, dear sis, why others shrink from this sight of a soul in bliss, so in the pink, from another month in the red of the shambles, like a rose in over its head among brambles. Unflappable in its belief, its Ararat on which the ark would come to grief, abjuring that Marcus Aurelius humbug about what springs from earth, succumbing to the tug at its heart strings. Reported to live past 50, as you yet may, dear sis, perhaps growing your hair in requital, though briefly, of whatever tears at your vitals, learning perhaps from the nifty, nay, thrifty way these buzzards are given to stoop and take their ease by letting their time-chastened poop fall to their knees till they're almost as bright with lime as their night roost, their poop containing an enzyme that's known to boost their immune systems should they prong themselves on small bones round a cerebral cortex at no small cost to their well-being, sinking fast in a deer crypt. Buzzards getting the hang at last of being stripped of their command of the vortex, while having lost their common touch, they've been so long above it all. Okay, a little song, I think, if I may. Oh, yes.
So this is called Cleaning Up My Act, and it's a lyric that has to do with, some of the ways in which we have allowed ourselves to be taken over and taken in by various usages that are really not to be taken at face value. One of my favorites is the direct flight, which, as you know, perhaps bitterly, does not mean a non-stop flight, right? I mean, please, I think we have to say, please. This first line, my son, who's 14 at the moment, tells me that it really came from him, so I have to acknowledge that. I don't quite believe it, but anyway, I am acknowledging it. So, cleaning up my act. There are no gentlemen in a gentleman's club. A direct flight to Reno may stop at a hub. I flagged behind my flagon of Côte du Rhône. You'd passed out in the passion wagon when I asked you home. I told you it's a condo, it's a cold water flat. The tricks I've played are dirty tricks. That's why I'm cleaning up my act. Nothing is a problem to a problem child, though the issue of labeling sends me hog wild. I'd pick up the plot that thickens around a free-range pig. I'd check out a fresh chicken to find it's been deep chilled. When did you last hear a kettle call a kettle black? I've been defiled by your sales pitch. That's why I'm cleaning up my act. For I was taken in by the identical twin of a pole dancer from Denver, my oh my. As for her skin, it was barely as thin as the pretext under which she asked me why there are no gentlemen in a gentleman's club. No room for nuclear families in a nuclear sub. A flight may run from Reno to a renal ward. A tall cappuccino turns out to be small. Minnie's a mass of sugar sells itself as low fat. I'm hoping to be filthy rich. That's why I'm cleaning up my act. I think just two poems, and that should bring us in, as it were. Yes, we'll do a Lowell, if we may, because honestly, you know, he is, I think for any of us who are attempting to, you know, have these adventures in language, allow the language to have adventures with us, and coincidentally, I suppose, hope that, you know, what ensues might in some, however modest way, be equal to the moment, which is certainly something that he tried to do. You really can't fault his sense of the role of the poet, the possibility that poetry might have in our society, and the role of the poet in our society. And, you know, however bumptious that seems betimes, and I think he was bumptious enough in his way, it's an idea I think we have to hold on to. Skunk R. Nautilus Island's hermit heiress still lives through winter in her Spartan cottage. Her sheep still graze above the sea. Her son's a bishop. Her farmer is first select man in our village. She's in her dotage. Thirsting for the hierarchic privacy of Queen Victoria's century, she buys up all the eyesores facing her shore and lets them fall. The season's ill. We've lost our summer millionaire.
who seemed to leap from an L.L. Bean catalogue. His nine-knot yawl was auctioned off to fishermen. A red fox stain covers Blue Hill. And now our fairy decorator brightens his shop for fall, his fishnets filled with orange cork, orange his cobbler's bench and all. There's no money in his work, he'd rather marry. One dark night, my Tudor Ford climbed the hill skull. I watched for love cars. Lights turned on, they lay together, hull to hull, where the graveyard shelves on the town. My mind's not right. A car radio bleats. Love, oh careless love. I hear my ill spirit sob in each blood cell, as if my hand were at its throat. I myself am hell. Nobody's here. Only skunks that search in the moonlight for a bite to eat. They march on their souls up Main Street, white stripes, moonstruck eyes, red fire under the chalk, dry, and spire of the Trinitarian Church. I stand on top of our back steps and breathe the rich air. A mother skunk with her column of kittens swills the garbage pail. She jabs her wedge head in a cup of sour cream, drops her ostrich tail, and will not scare. And I'll end more or less where I began, with a poem having to do with Cuba. This is called Cuba 2. It's a poem having to do with, thank you so much for coming, guys. Bye. Having to do with a visit I made to Cuba a couple of years ago with my daughter, who's now 21. And it's just a little account of some of the things we got up to and some of the things that happened to us. And I look forward to the opportunity of having a chat with you over a light refreshment. A heavy refreshment? I have no idea. Out there in a minute or two. And in the meantime, I would very much like to say what an honor it is to share this occasion with you, to have been invited to come here under this particular aegis, and I'm very honored. Cuba, too. I'm hanging with my daughter in downtown Havana. She's worried people think she's my mail order bride. It might be the anchois tattooed on her ankle. It might be the tie-in with that poem of mine. The 59 Buicks, the 59 Chevys, the 59 Studebakers with their white-walled wheels. The rain-bleached streets have been put through a mangle. The sugar mills, too, are feeling the squeeze. We touch on how Ireland will be inundated long before the nil-nil draw. Che Guevara's father was one of the Galway lynchers. Now a genetically engineered catfish can crawl on its belly like an old-school gorilla. Maybe a diminished seventh isn't the note a half-decent revolution should end on. The poor with their hands out for pencils and soap. Hopped up though I am on caffeine, I've suffered all my life from post-traumatic fatigue. Even a world-class sleeper like Rip Van Winkle was out of it for only 20 years. A fillet of the fenny cobra may yet fold into a blood pressure drug. A passion for marijuana may yet be nipped in the bud. Some are here for a nose job, some a torn meniscus. The profits from health tourism have been salted away. The blue scorpion takes the sting from one cancer. Ovarian may yet leave us unfazed. Hemingway's sun hat is woven from raffia. He's tried everything to stop the rot. He's cut everything back to the bare essentials, his 55 Chryslers in the shop. We'll sit with Hemingway through yet another evening of trying to stay off the rum. I'm running down the list of my uncles. It was Uncle Pat who was marked by a gun. Our friends Mayor Lansky and the Jewish Mafia built the Riviera as a gambling club. Had it not been for the time differential, Uncle Arnie might have taken a cut. I should have mentioned, perhaps, or maybe I shouldn't mention in Boston, that I am related by marriage to a fellow called Arnold Rothstein. We don't really talk about it much, but we're all friends here, I'm sure. The best baseball bats are turned from hibiscus. They're good against people who get in your way. The best poems, meanwhile, give the answers to questions only they have raised. We touch on Bulat and Evgeny, two Russian friends who've since left town. The Cuban ground iguana is actually quite thin on the ground. The cigars we lit up on President's Avenue have won gold medals in the cigar games. Now it seems a cigar may twinkle all the more as the light fails. My daughters led me through Hemingway's villa to a desk round which dusk drinkers crowd. She insists the anchor on her Achilles tendon represents her being in the here and now. The cattle egret is especially elated that a plough may still be yoked to an ox. Others sigh for the era of three martini lunches and the Martini Henry single shot. When will we give Rothstein and Lansky and their heavies the collective heave? In Ireland, we need to start now to untangle the rhetoric of 2016. The Riviera's pool is shaped like a coffin. So much has been submerged here since the Bay of Pigs. Maybe that's why the buildings are wrinkled. Maybe that's why the cars have fins. Thank you.